base their whole religion upon always having an infallible present imam. They went to such an extent that they said it is incumbent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to always provide the people, his creation, with an infallible imam who will lead the people and will guide the people. They also go to the extent of saying that the earth, it only remains in existence because of these imams. See, we have the first section of hadith, first category of hadith, where the descriptions of a brief description is given of the imam's duties. That category of hadith refutes the concept of a hidden imam. Then we have a category of hadith which clearly mentions the word zahir, that this imam who is going to be there, he has to be apparent. This category of hadith, you'll find many different hadiths which mention that the imam has to be apparent. So that second category of hadith, that also states and shows, and we can understand from that the option of a hidden imam is bogus when it comes to Shiaism. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters, inshallah, this session is going to be about the 12th Imam which Shias believe in. Now, anybody with a slight bit of knowledge about Shiaism, they will know that the early Imam Shia, they had based their whole religion upon always having an infallible present Imam. Note the words always, infallible, and present. So they basically based their whole religion upon always having an infallible present imam. They went to such an extent that they said it is incumbent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to always provide the people, his creation, with an infallible imam who will lead the people and who will guide the people. Now the question arises they also go to the extent of saying that the earth, it only remains in existence because of these imams. And if it wasn't for the imams, the earth will crumble and will shake upon itself. So this is the extent and this is the importance they attach to such an aqidah. The question is what is the job, what are the duties of such an imam? Now, very basically, I just want to go through one or two of the things that are sort of attached to them and their roles and their objectives. Number one, you can see from the word imam that they are going to lead the people, they are going to guide the people. If anybody comes and adds anything to their religion, they shall come and remove the addition. Anybody that comes and removes anything from their original religion, they will come and they will preserve and they will protect their religion. They shall explain the scriptures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the people. It is to them that the people will go and refer their haram and their halal. Any new things that come up in the religion, anything, any new topics, any new issues that arise because of time moving and advancing, they will give decisions. Basically, their decision counts in religious issues. Similarly, in political issues, it is their decision that will be referred to. Now, the evidences for this, Usul al-Kafi, a book we've talked about many a times before, written by Muhammad bin Yaqub al-Kulaini. In there he brings a narration. He says, إِنَّ الْأَرْضَ لَا تَخْلُو إِلَّا وَفِيهَا إِمَامٌ كَيْمَا إِنْ زَادَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ شَيْئًا رَدَّهُمْ وَإِنْ نَقَصُوا شَيْئًا أَتَمَّهُ لَهُمْ. The Imam, he brings this narration is from their books, in which it says that the earth will never be empty of an Imam. This Imam, if anybody adds anything to the religion, he shall refute it. If anybody removes anything from the religion, then he will keep the religion complete and he will preserve and protect the religion. In another narration mentioned in a book called Basair al-Darajat, again is a book of the Shias, in there there's another narration in which the narrator Ya'qub bin Siraj qala, he says, قُلْتُ لِأَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ. I said to Abu Abdullah. Abu Abdullah is the appellation, is the kunyat of Ja'far al-Sadiq rahimahullah ta'ala an. So he says, I said, قُلْتُ لِأَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ تَخْلُو الْأَرْضُ مِنْ عَالِمٍ مِنْكُمْ حَيٌّ ظَاهِرٌ. يفزع إليه الناس في حلالهم وحرامهم قال لا أبا يا أبا يوسف لا إن ذلك لبين في كتاب الله تعالى فقال يا أيها الذين آمنوا اصبروا وصابروا أي عدوكم ممن يخالفكم ورابطوا أي إمامكم واتقوا الله أي فيما يعمركم وفرض عليكم. Now يعقوب بن سراج he says that I said to Abu Abdullah that O Abu Abdullah will the earth ever remain empty of an imam who is alive and who is apparent, note the word apparent in this narration. So he asks that will there ever be a time where the earth will be empty of such a person to whom the people can refer to regarding their halal and haram. So Ja'far al-Sadiq, he replied to the person, he said, La, no. As in, a time can never come when the earth will be empty of an apparent imam, not apparent, a living imam. A time will never, such a time will never ever come. Then he moves on and he tries to prove this, well, allegedly, he tries to prove this from a verse of the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O those who have believed, isbiru, remain patient, persevere, wasabiru, and endure. And the commentary he mentions is, who should you endure? Your enemies who have opposed you. And then the Quran ayat comes again, warabitu, as in remain stationed. Who should we remain stationed with? The commentary is, imamakum, your imam. And then he follows on by saying, Wattaqullah fi Allah, what should you fear Allah in fi ma ya'murukum, in those things which Allah instructs you, wa faradha alaykum, and he makes obligatory upon you. So from the two narrations, we can get a brief understanding of what the imam is all about, what the duties are of this imam, and what his roles are, what his jobs are when he comes into the dunya. Now the question is if the imam is so important, then we see for the past 1200 years, the Shias, they've been in such a distressful state that these poor things, they've not had an imam. We haven't seen an imam for the past 1200 years. Now to console themselves and to give a bit of solace to their sheepish public, what they've concocted a concept of an hidden imam. And what they say is roughly in the year 255 AH, they say that a child was born, and this child's birth was so secret, even the commoners in his area, even they didn't know that he was born. And at the age of about 5 or 6 years old, fearing his life, he disappeared into a cave. And he's been there for the past, mashallah, 1200 years. I don't know what he's been eating and drinking, but you know, there's seriously no McDonald's there, right? Anyway, so this is, you know, to give a bit of solace to their community, to the Shias, they've said that he's gone and he's in hiding. Now the question arises, is this disappearance and hiding in a cave, can the Shias actually justify this from their own teachings? An imam who is supposed to lead them, can they actually justify this from their own teachings? And this is what I want to talk about today, and this is what I want to show to our Shia brothers and sisters, that this is something that you really need to look at in your own books, that this disappearance, can Shiaism from their books and their sources, their main, you know, solid sources, can they actually prove this? Can they actually justify this disappearance of the imam? According to the two above narrations which I have mentioned, and according to all those narrations which are in the books of Shia, which are similar to this, as in those which give us a description of the jobs and the roles and the duties of an imam, these type of narrations, this category, this section of narrations, clearly refutes the fact, but clearly refutes that an hidden imam is not an option in Shiaism. Why? Just look at the narrations. They say his job is, he is a leader. If he's a leader and he's hiding, how is he supposed to lead the people? His job is to guide the people. If he's hiding, how is he supposed to guide the people? The job of an imam is so that people can refer to him regarding their halal and their haram. If he is hiding in some mountain that nobody knows, in some cave that nobody knows, how are people supposed to refer to him when they want to know about halal and haram? If his job is to explain the scriptures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is he going to explain those scriptures to, apart from spiders and snakes and scorpions that he's going to see in the cave? His job is to that he explains the scriptures, and similarly the new issues that crop up in the ummah, his job is to solve those. If he's hiding, first of all, how is he going to know about what's cropping up in the ummah? What are the new issues? And second, how are the people going to refer back to him? So from these two narrations that I've mentioned, and many narrations like these two narrations, which give us a description of the imam's duties and roles, these such narrations require that the imam should be present and not hidden. So they clearly refute the concept of a hidden imam. Again, if we look, there are other narrations. We have another category of narrations which clearly, absolutely inconspicuously, they show that the imam who is supposed to be leading the people, the imam who is going to guide the people and to whom they are going to refer to regarding the halal and haram, he has to be apparent. For example, we have a narration mentioned in Usulul Kafi again, لَا تَبْقَ الْأَرْضُ بِغَيْرِ إِمَامٍ زَاهِرٍ. Now if you look in the narration, the word zahir is clearly mentioned. The translation of the narration is لَا تَبْقَ الْأَرْضُ, the earth will not remain without an apparent imam, as in the imam has to be apparent. A time will never come over the earth where there will not be an apparent imam. There will always should be an apparent imam, according to the Aqidah, obviously, of the Shias. So this narration and many other narrations, if you know it, the second narration I mentioned are the first two. That narration also had the word zahir. When the Yaqub bin Siraj, he asks Ja'far al-Sadiq, takhlu al-ardu min alimin minkum hayyun zahir, that will a time ever come where the earth will become empty of an apparent imam? So see, we have the first section of hadith, first category of hadith, where the descriptions of a brief description is given of the imam's duties. That category of hadith refutes the concept of a hidden imam. Then we have a category of hadith which clearly mentions the word zahir, that this imam who is going to be there, he has to be apparent. This category of hadith, you'll find many different hadith which mention that the imam has to be apparent. So that second category of hadith, that also states and shows, and we can understand from that the option of a hidden imam is bogus when it comes to Shiaism. And then we have a third category of hadith in which is mentioned that you have to know the imam. You have to know that the imam has to be known. So for example, I'll give you an example again in Usulul Kafi and Basairul Darajat, we have narrations such as إِنَّ الْحُجَّةَ لَا تَقُومُ لِلَّهِ عَلَىٰ خَلْقِهِ إِلَّا بِإِمَامٍ حَتَّى يُعْرَفُ, that the Hujjah of Allah, the proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will not be established upon his creation until there is an imam who is known. Not until there is an imam. Until there is an imam who is known, there's two conditions. One is the imam has to be there. One, the imam has to be known. So that until the imam is not known, until he is not recognized, until then the Hujjah, the proof of Allah, is not established upon the creation. Now what does this mean? What does it mean by the Hujjah of Allah, the proof of Allah is not established? This means that until the Imam is not known, all the Shias, they are religiously not accountable. As in, on the day of Qiyamah, whatever they do, if they do not know their Imam, they will not be religiously accountable on the day of Qiyamah. This is what it means. So basically, what does this mean? It means that there has to be an imam and the imam has to be known. Now if he's hidden, then how can you know a hidden imam? There's a clear contradiction, that for an imam to be known, he has to be present. But we see that the Shias, what do they say? The Shias say he is absent. He's hidden, he's not. So absent and present are totally opposites. So we see from here that again, that the imam has to be present, he has to be known. And this third category of hadith, there's many different hadith regarding the same thing, knowing. In Usulul Kafi, there's another hadith which says that you should know your imam. There's an instruction, know your imam. If you know your imam, then nothing will harm you, whether this matter comes early or whether this matter is delayed. This is another hadith that you can, another narration that you can find in the books of Shia, especially Usulul Kafi. So like this, there's many other hadiths which inform the Shias that they need to know the imam. You have to know the imam. Now, we know for the past 1200 years, no Shia can come and say, I know the 12th Imam. Nobody's seen him, nobody's heard him, nobody's smelled him, nobody knows anything about him. Well, if he's only 5 years old, what are you going to know about him? There's not going to be much to know about him if he's... nobody knows about his birth. Even the commoners that were there, they don't know about his birth. So one thing, you don't know anything about his birth. Second, at the age of five or six years old, he's going to disappear into a cave. What are you going to know about a five-year-old? So, first of all, the hadith is telling us, the narration is telling us, we have to know the Imam. So this category of hadith, third, which is the third category, this also refutes any concept of a hidden Imam. Now, the first category of hadith, the Shias, they can't say anything about the stoke. The second category of hadith, where it clearly mentions that the Imam has to be apparent, again, the Shias can't say, really, they don't have a real answer for it. This third category, the Shias actually try to answer it, because obviously they're stuck. For the past 1200 years, this would mean, because no Shia knows the 12th Imam, this would mean for the past 1200 years, all those Shias who don't know the Imam, they are not accountable on the day of Qiyamah, because the Hujjah of Allah is not established among them, because none of them know the Imam. So what do they say? They say that we know the Imam from the Hadith. We know the Imam from the Hadith, and this is sufficient. This is absolutely stupid. This is stupid, sheer stupidity this is. Why? Because this statement can only be made by such a person who is absolutely ignorant of the fundamental differences between Muslims and Shia. If you remember what I said in the beginning, the Shias have based their religion upon always having an infallible Imam. So knowing him from Hadith basically has just shattered the foundations of Shiaism. They have just, by saying this, you go against your own principle, which is, if knowing him from the Hadith is sufficient, that shows that you don't always need an Imam who is present and who is infallible. Let me give you an example to finish off with. You have a huge business firm, and in the business firm, the employees, they split up into two groups. Group A say, we need a manager who is always going to overlook us, and this manager is necessary for the business. So that the business goes forward, we need a manager to overlook us. Group B, they say, no, we don't need any manager. We can do this on our own. We have the owner of the firm. Other than that, we don't need any manager. Now, what happens is a manager is employed. After the manager is employed and he sits at home, the owner says to him, you can sit at home. Group A says, yes, that's fine. He can sit at home. So when Group B asks them, well, what's the point of that? They say, well, we know we've got a manager. He doesn't need to be here. We know he's got a manager. So what Group B was saying is absolutely correct, that, well, you don't need him. If he's not going to be in the firm, helping us and overlooking us, then what does that show? And if him being at home is sufficient for the progression of the business, then that just goes to show that what we were saying is absolutely fine, that we don't need an Imam. And this is the fundamental difference between the Muslims and Shia. Muslims say, we don't need an Imam. After the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hadith of the Prophet and what he has left us, the Quran, that is sufficient. But if they say that we need an Imam always who is infallible and present, then saying that we know him from hadith, this is not sufficient, is total stupidity. And okay, if for argument's sake somebody said that yes, we know him from hadith and this is enough for us, then I just want to say that we also know him from hadith. We also know him for hadith, but we see that the Shias, what they say? They say the Muslims, the Ahli Sunnah, the Sunnis, they are misguided. We know him from hadith just as well as you know him from hadith. If you knowing him from hadith is sufficient for your savior, then why is it not sufficient for our savior? And the second thing is, we know somebody who is far greater than the 12th Imam. We know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from hadith and from the Quran. Why is that not sufficient? Why is it sufficient to know the 12th Imam from Hadith so that he can be a savior for you? But when it comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no, that's not sufficient for a savior. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give our brothers and sisters understanding, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them tawfiq to look into their books, what it says in their books, and to question their scholars regarding the aqidahs, regarding the info that they are being given from the books. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us true understanding of the deen. May Allah give us true understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
في رحلة تطوي الدروب بين المدائن والشعوب بحضرة الذكر الحكيم في رحلة تطوي الدروب بين المدائن والشعوب